Greetings, everyone. Hello, we're live again with our Sound United webinars. Today, we're continuing with part two, which is a special guest, because it's a familiar face to most of us, it's Jeff Clark. And he's a director of software engineering from Audyssey. So welcome back, Jeff.
Thank you.
What's your first impression of the new office space?
I am loving it. I'm loving it. It sounds great. You've got a lot of resources here, a lot of rooms to work with. It's thoroughly impressive.
Awesome. I can't wait to see it myself. Now, Jeff and Phil are joining us from the building, and today it's all about the room calibration, anything Audyssey related. Now, without further ado, I am going to hand it over now to Phil and Jeff, live from our new office in Carlsbad. Take it away, gentlemen.
Thank you. Good morning, afternoon, evening, depending on where you're at. Here it is 9 p.m., and I convinced Jeff to actually come and hang out with me to do these sessions. And I'm happy to have Audyssey here because Sound United and Audyssey have a long history together. And it's great to be able to work with gentlemen like Jeff when it comes to to audio products, because he's as passionate about audio and cars as I am. So before we get started, Jeff, can you talk a little bit about Audyssey, the company itself?
Sure. You know, one of our very first products that were that our multi-Q technology shipped in was a Denon. It was the 5805, and that was a flagship way back when. But that technology was a couple of years prior to that in development out of research at USC. So we had a couple of professors, Tom Holman, Chris Kyriakakis, names some of you guys are familiar with. And they got together and said, well, there's this unsolved problem in theater and home theater, both. There's a lot of work and a lot of special equipment required to do an equalization of a proper equalization of a room. And they figured, well, they teamed up with a PhD student and MultiQ was created. From there, we broadened into other home theater technologies to bring a reference experience, sort of was the company philosophy, try to get it as close to what the director's intent was as we could, and then allow people to build their customizations on top of that.
Yeah. So we, like I said, we have this long history, and so we've been putting Audyssey into our products for what, nearly, we're talking 15, 16, 17 years. As you go along the building and we talk about it, we have a variety of demo spaces and all those home theater spaces. I think we have like 5 home theater systems, including the one that we're going to talk about today, that we're in today, that we use Audyssey to fine-tune the room. Interesting thing, today is our anniversary. The first time we did an Audyssey session, Jeff was at home and I was at home because it was the middle of COVID and neither one of us could travel. And we did this first session, a session on best optimizing the use of Audyssey in a home. And we took it, and those sessions are, by the way, are still up on the Sound United YouTube channel. So make sure you still check those out. But the way that we met was I was doing a different webinar and Audyssey came up as a question and you were listening to the webinar and said, hey, I know a little bit about I know a little bit about the topic. And then you just started coming and we've had you on for a lot of different ones, like picking the best demos and just great demo content and movie content,
speaker
stuff
placement,
like that.
Speaker
placement, software replacement, all sorts of good stuff. So it's always been great to have you here. And like I said, this building has a lot of great demo spaces in it. So as we go along, we have all of these great demo spaces because we're an audio company. So we have big speaker walls. We have a hi-fi room, which I was actually in with Dave doing this session last week. And then we have multiple little sound rooms. We can set up systems for product testing and product comparison and demonstrations of smaller systems. And then, of course, we have the room that we're in right now, which is our bigger reference system. So this room is still under construction. It's going to have a lot more acoustic treatments and all of that stuff in it. So don't say, where's your acoustic treatments? Is that it? We're going to, believe me, in the next 4 to 5 months, this room is going to transform. And all of the speakers you see you won't see. It'll all be hidden behind pretty acoustic panels to make the room more exciting. Big system. I wanted a system that was effortless. A little later, we're going to talk about the difference between large speakers that you think are large and truly large speakers. So you can see here that the center channel and the mains in these systems and the surrounds are what we would call large. Before we get started, we'll talk a little bit about the system, because every time we're sitting in here, people go, what's in the room, Phil? What's in the room? So in the room is, we're currently set up for a 7.1.6. The purple in the drawing are actually two subwoofers. So remember, 0.1 means there's only one LFE channel, but we use multiple subwoofers. If you look at the drawing, you'll see that there's a green and a red square. The red is the large surround speaker, and they sit on top of the little green thing, which is a 15-inch bass driver, because each channel has one. So each channel is full range, and of course we have all of our in-ceiling speakers. We're only using six of the in-ceilings now, but you'll notice that if you look at the little orange speaker, we have a center front height capability. We have a voice of God, or a top surround capability, which both can be used for Auro 3D or DTSX. We even have a center rear height, which can be utilized for both DTSX Pro, and it can also be utilized as a surround channel for Dolby Atmos in the future. So the goal was to build a room that we can continue to move along. You'll see that there's these two gigantic racks. Those are the racks behind Jeff that hold all of the AV equipment to drive this room. The system is big, very big, and this is all Bowers, and we wanted to build a system that was effortless in its performance, the ability to effortlessly play back any type of musical content, whether it's music content or whether it's Saving Private Ryan and bombs and explosions. We wanted the system to be effortless. You can see that each of the surround channels, with the exception of the center channel, have a 15-inch bass module to go along with it, along with two large DB1D Bowers subwoofers for the LFE and a variety of other speakers, as you can see. We chose the Bowers Custom Theater, the ones we chose were the CT8.2s and the CT SW15. So this represents what you would see on the left channel, the right channel, the surround channels, and the surround back channels. Needless to say, the bass is effortless. It plays quite loud and quite clean, and I think it sounds outstanding, even though the room is not completely finished. And it's a bargain at $7,500 a channel. And I think that is, if you can afford it, it is worth every single penny. Each of the 15-inch woofers, by the way, they go, what are you driving them with? Bowers SA1000 series mono amplifiers that drive each of the 15s. If you look over here, you'll see a whole bunch of green lights, and those are the amplifiers below that run the bass of the surround channels. Above that, you'll see a stack of Marantz PM10s. That stack of PM10s run the heights. And actually, you can see one of the big speakers back behind Jeff. If he leans that way.
That way.
There you go. Right behind him. You can see it. That sucker is, what, 5.5? I think it's about at least five feet tall. By the time you put the woofer and the bass module together, it's a pretty substantial.
I would say the
sound.
Pictures don't quite do it justice.
The pictures don't quite really do it justice. Maybe we'll have a contest for people and have them have a chance to come check it out. But these big amplifiers, there's four of them. They are PM10s. They're Marantz's flagship integrated. We're using basically so each of the large speakers, each of the large surround speakers are getting at least 200 watts plus the 1,000. So you're looking at 1,200 watts per channel. So at a minimum, so pretty effortless. Lots and lots and lots of headroom. I love this rack. It's completely over the top. But what we're going to talk about, all this stuff we're talking about for this rack, by the way, this is a big, elaborate rack. But the process of how Audyssey works, applies to whether you buy a receiver that costs $500 or you spend, I don't know, a $250,000 US to build a room like this by the time you have the TV and the projectors and stuff. But the concept of how Audyssey works, the benefits of Audyssey, the way that you tune Audyssey, the way that you get the best bass out of Audyssey, all of that stays the same regardless of the budget that you are actually spending. Let's talk a little bit about the features that are built into Audyssey. So let's talk a little bit about this electronic room compensation. So the first thing you want to stress to people is before you apply Audyssey, make sure you put the speakers in the best position possible. Make sure you use as much, if you can use acoustic room treatments, you know, diffusers, absorption, curtains, things like that, to kind of dampen down harsh reflections and stuff like that. Do that first. Place your subwoofers in the best position you possibly can. Then you apply electronic room compensation.
Sounds good.
So one thing you explained to me was we were talking about when timing is important on speakers. Because if you look at this, there's multiple things that it does. It, number one, determines how large the size of your speakers, how loud you need to play each channel, but also timing. Can you talk about the importance of timing? And you always use that rain analogy.
I do,
which
yeah.
I really like.
It's one of my favorite demos from Open Range, where there's a scene, and this was one of the early Audyssey demos that we would do, and one of my first experiences demoing the system. And it was we'd take it out to various rooms, and every single time you'd play the scene with an uncalibrated system. Then you'd time, level, align, and EQ everything. And instead of having sort of pink noise for rain, you would have raindrops. Raindrops everywhere that you could hear and that were distinguishable. And that's always been something that just stuck with me is what a calibrated system sounds like.
Instead of white noise, it actually sounds like rain. The other thing that we talk about a lot is it does a lot of stuff, multi-EQ. Before we get into the differences and what that does, the system will measure, the Audyssey will measure your room using the microphone. And sometimes you think your speaker is large, but Audyssey says it's not. Can you explain why that happens sometimes?
Sure. I mean, we have the great example right here with a center channel that has measured as small. And, you know, in the parlance, in those words of the AVR, small just means we're bass managing it. We're taking the bass from the speaker that it may not be able to handle fully and directing it to a speaker that can, which is the subwoofer, or potentially, if you don't have a subwoofer, the other speakers in the system. This seems like a system that could probably run okay without a subwoofer, but hey, more is better.
Exactly, and that's a big point. You may go out and buy the nicest speaker. It's a big speaker, and on paper, it's supposed to play really deep, but to Audyssey, if it doesn't play full range, 20 to 20, and it requires a little bit of bass help, I don't care if it's 50 hertz down or 40 hertz down, it's small. That's just the way it is.
Now, you may actually have a speaker that in an anechoic measurement environment, in some sort of perfect environment, does measure to 20 hertz, but in the room it doesn't. And, and that's a result of maybe there's a null and maybe there's you know, room, they're just room acoustics.
How the room interacts with the speaker. So Audyssey doesn't care what the spec is on your on the piece of paper. What it cares about is how that speaker responds in your space. How deep will it play in the position that microphone is placed in your space? And sometimes you may think it should be large, but it's not. So it's not trying to break your heart. It's just making an accurate thing. Now, sometimes it is large. Like if you look at the ones in this room, if you look at the mains, we're running, you know, this speaker is gigantic. You know, it's a 15-inch woofer sitting here with 1,000 watts. It goes down to all the way. In fact, like, I think this is rated, these are rated for 16, and I'll show you later the chart. There's a lot of bass down in the 20 and 30. So that is what Audyssey will say is a large speaker.
Absolutely.
So in this room, we're running six large. And a small center channel, but the center channel is being played down to 40. So only thing that's being sent to the subwoofers is 40 to 20 something for that's in the center channel and any the LFE, of course, and any of the bass for the speakers in the ceiling which are also small.
Because and their own sort of special case, which exactly. is, you were telling me they measured, they suggested a crossover of 60, was mm-hmm. it?
Yeah.
And maybe even 40. Mm-hmm. So sometimes these are a pretty large driver. Sometimes they will produce enough sound to mm-hmm. be detected as a speaker that can play a little lower than you really want to push them.
Exactly. And I was thinking about that. I was like, why did the speakers in the ceiling measure so low? But I'm like, okay, first thing, they're an 8-inch woofer. And we haven't put the back boxes in. We're going to put the back boxes in after we redo the ceiling tiles.
Right.
Because they're playing into an infinite baffle, it can play pretty low, but it doesn't have as much control because it doesn't have the back box. So while right. it plays low, if I throw that type of bass at it, I don't have that back box there.
You'll exceed the excursion
of the speaker. And right. probably when I put the back box in, they'll have better control, but they won't have, it won't play as low, and
might
that
not.
Will tell
yeah.
me the
measure. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah, I'm very curious to compare yeah. the measurements after you put the back boxes in for the ceiling speakers versus what we put in. Right. So the moral of the story, people, is if you see your speakers indicated as small, that is because in your room, the receiver is going to utilize the subwoofers to give that channel, to get that channel to play full range. The next thing is things like distance. There's acoustic different distance and there's measured distance. Because I get asked that all the time. How come when I Audyssey says these two speakers have a different distance? Why is that? Why don't they measure the same? I measured it with my tape measure. I say it's 12 feet. Audyssey says it's 13. Mm-hmm. What's going on there?
In most cases, what's going on is, and this is most common with the subwoofer, there's some additional processing in the electronics of the subwoofer. Mm-hmm. And the subwoofer electronics introduce their own delay to mm-hmm. the signal. So mm-hmm. that delay comes across as acoustic or electroacoustic distance. Mm-hmm. So the speaker may be 12 feet, but if it adds, let's say, a few milliseconds of processing delay, that's a few extra feet equivalent mm-hmm. of distance. And so in order to play at the same time as all the other speakers, you actually need to dial that into yeah. the distance.
So, one
so that's what we measure.
1 foot is how many milliseconds? I remember.
It's about one.
So 1 millisecond. Yeah. So if there's a 1/1000th of a second delay, that's the difference between one, you know, a foot
yeah.
or a third of a meter.
And it matters.
So, and it
does,
matters.
And it does matter. Yeah.
So the first thing that Audyssey has to do is go in, determine the size of the speakers, mm-hmm. How far away they are, you know, and then it applies multi-Q. Can you talk about what multi-Q?
Then we also gauge how loud they play.
Oh, how loud they play.
How sensitive they are. Mm-hmm. And so that's another component of it that you'll see with the subwoofer. In most cases, you'll run through a pre-level alignment. Mm-hmm. And so we'll talk more about that later, but it helps you get the subwoofer in the range that the trims mm-hmm. of the AVR can then handle.
Okay. So, and then you and add then, multi-Q.
And then we get to multi-Q, yeah.
So there's different levels of multi-Q. So multi-Q, that's kind of like your equalization.
Multi-Q is our room equalization. Mm-hmm.
And technology. There's multiple levels depending on the processing power that's built into the AVR.
Right.
And we'll talk about those three different levels as we go along.
Sure.
So we talk about, the next thing is, in order to get the best results, you need to measure more than one position.
Sure, some basic why? Measurement guidelines.
Yeah, why do you need to measure more than one position?
More information is better. The more we have information for, mm-hmm. the more we can compute a best fit curve for the room, for mm-hmm. the listening area, not for the whole room. Mm-hmm. We don't care what happens over near the wall. Mm-hmm. So we don't want to measure near the wall. Mm-hmm. We don't want to measure on the floor mm-hmm. or on the seat, directly on the seat. Uh-huh. We want to measure where ears are. So you have the option of a tripod. There's the support that comes with the AVR.
Papers, the little paper.
They're
one.
Super cool, mm-hmm. pretty clever solution. But you don't want to handhold the microphone. Mm-hmm. So it depends on having a very still mm-hmm. Microphone for the measurements. Mm-hmm. We want to quiet any background noises, mm-hmm. air conditioners. Sometimes they're really subtle mm-hmm. and have really significant effects in the low frequencies. Mm-hmm. That's actually something that can trip up the distance algorithm. Mm-hmm. So if you measure it repeatedly and you get inconsistent results, mm-hmm. there's usually background noise that's interfering with
it. Okay. So multiple positions, better understanding of the room. Yeah. Now, the interesting thing about you're talking about, it only cares about the mic. like we were in here and we were doing, I was doing, what was that demo we were doing? Heartbreak Ridge, whatever that battle one is. Oh, and when you're, Hacksaw Ridge. And it is the most, it is the craziest Atmos demo. There's bombs going everywhere. It's just intense. When you're sitting in the seats where the microphones are calibrated, the blend is just beautiful. But when you're standing in the back of the room, because of the, like where Jeff's sitting with that speaker, he was standing kind of where he is now, where he's sitting now, and that speaker's there, it feels like it's going to, that rear feel like it's going to rip your head off. And it's, I was like, intense. Man, it really seems like it's too loud. But yeah. Then when I sit in the main, whenever I sat in the main seat, I'm like, it's perfect. So the microphones only care about the designated listening position.
Yeah.
The money seats, the best way I can explain it. All right. So moving on from that, we have some other things that are available. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about dynamic volume. What is that and why would you use it?
Dynamic volume matches what we All right. So we measured what people do when they listen to a movie in a living room environment, kind of like this, maybe not quite as fancy. Mm-hmm. And people invariably move the volume control throughout the movie. Mm-hmm. When the loud scenes get too loud, they turn it down. Mm-hmm. When there's really soft dialogue, they turn it up. Mm-hmm. So what dynamic volume does is it models what you want to do with the, what you would probably want to do with the volume control. Mm-hmm. If you're listening at a full-on reference level, then you probably don't need this, don't want it, and the quiet parts are loud enough, and the loud parts are really loud, and you want it that way. That's fine. But for a lot of other listening situations where you don't want it at max volume, or where you want to keep from bothering your neighbors, or if you're listening to some kind of content that has commercials that come on and they just knock you out of your seat, then dynamic volume gets there before you can pick up the remote. It dials the volume back or brings it up as needed.
Yeah. And so, yeah, so it really works well not to disturb others. We go back to that movie we were just watching, Heartbreak Ridge or whatever that movie we were watching.
Hacksaw Ridge.
Okay. Yeah. For the first hour of the movie, it's regular basic dialogue and it's a drama and it's about him going to boot camp and it's a little bit of volume. And then the battle scene happens and it goes from 0 to 1,000 miles an hour instantly. And I guarantee you most people have the volume up to hear the dialogue. And when that happens, they're all running towards the remote control if they're watching something at like 11 o'clock at night. This helps eliminate that.
And there are multiple settings for dynamic volume. So if you want to watch something like Hacksaw Ridge, you could set it to kind of light. It's got a light setting and it won't do too much. So you'll still get that huge impact of that scene without losing the dialogue in the other scenes.
Yeah, so. I've had that happen where the kids are upstairs watching a movie in the theater and my wife's downstairs and all of a sudden it goes from, you know, it's a battle scene and then she's calling me, tell them to turn it down. So, you know, so being able to go in and do dynamic volume, the kids aren't going to really care.
No.
It's still going to be a great experience for them. Now, the next thing is dynamic EQ. So what is dynamic EQ?
Dynamic EQ is a technology that compensates for how our ears hear different sound levels. So some people may have heard of the Fletcher-Munson curves. Those are also called equal loudness contours, all fancy ways of saying that when you turn it down, the bass and the treble are actually heard less. So I turn the volume down 10 dB. Everything's down 10 dB. Bass is down 10 dB, the treble is down 10 dB, the mid-range is down 10 dB, but our ears kind of hear it more like 15 dB lower in the bass and treble. So what dynamic EQ allows you to do is turn the volume down, keep the impact. So it will raise back up the bass and the very lows and the very highs to maintain the tonal balance, even though you've turned the volume down. So it allows you to listen at less than reference volume with full reference impact.
Exactly. And as you turn it up to reference level, it basically
goes away.
It goes away. Right. Now, there's a big thing about that. So what's reference level? I have the receiver, the processor. We're using an AV8805 in this room. And I have it set to, there's different ways you can have the meter from 0 to like 89 or 90, or you can have it set to dB. Starts off with a minus dB number and goes up to a plus dB number. zero is reference level. I haven't played this at zero. I get it normally to about six or minus six or minus five. It's loco. Maybe with all the acoustic treatments in here, I could probably get it to zero because it'll. But that is reference level. So many people think they play it at reference level, but you don't. If you have it from the zero to 90 something, I think it's like in the mid 80s. When you turn your knob, is where reference is on there, like 79 to like 83. If you're turning the knob, so it basically turns it off. Now, some people have said, and I'm that when they use this dynamic EQ, that sometimes it's doing too much.
Yeah.
So you guys have, you have the trim capabilities in here. Can you talk about what that is? If I go into, this is actually the menu of the receiver. So if I go down here to Audyssey, there's this thing called dynamic EQ, and right under that you have reference offset. So right. What is that?
Reference offset was originally designed for content that was mixed to different reference levels. Mm-hmm. So movies have been mixed to reference levels for a long time. They mm-hmm. have a sort of a standard. There have been they're designed to be played back in every theater the same way, mm-hmm. and including a home theater. So there's a reference experience sensitivity that they expect, and mm-hmm. not everything is mixed to that. So TV may be mixed differently, mm-hmm. CDs may be mixed differently, especially CDs. So especially mm-hmm. with loud pop music, mm-hmm. they're mixed to what we would say a higher reference level. So mm-hmm. what's encoded onto the CD at a higher level isn't really meant to be played back as loud as a movie mm-hmm. would be played back. So mm-hmm. that's what the reference level offset gives you, is to say, okay, we add this mount, this reference level, to the volume setting. So if you set that to 10, then now dynamic EQ is doing nothing at minus 10 mm-hmm. on the volume setting.
Mm-hmm. And then you have 15.
Yes.
So you have 0, 10, and 0, 5, 10, 15. So if something is recorded louder, you can switch this on.
Yeah, so if you're getting a little too much bass when you turn the volume down and a mm-hmm. little too much treble when you turn the volume mm-hmm. down, you can dial it in here.
Exactly.
The other thing that dynamic EQ does is it boosts the surrounds just a little bit, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. just a little bit to sort of compensate for the way sound is perceived in a home versus a theater.
Exactly.
So sometimes that's a little too much, mm-hmm. especially if you're sitting kind of close to the surrounds. Mm-hmm. And so what we can do about that is we can try changing the reference level offset, although that's not really what it's meant for. Mm-hmm. Another thing you can do is you can actually just change the trims. Mm-hmm. So if you're always listening with dynamic EQ, which I certainly recommend, mm-hmm. And you find that the surrounds are boosted too much, mm-hmm. you can just bring the trims down just a little bit.
This, I actually use dynamic EQ in my home. In this system, we have it set to off. That, and no one says it's lacking bottom end.
Yeah.
Or I wish it had more high frequency. At the levels that I'm getting really close to reference level. So the next thing you want to talk about is there some additional features as you move up the lineup. We say there's multiple levels of Audyssey processing in our receivers. And as you move up and get a smarter, a more powerful Audyssey processing, you get more levels of adjustment, like multi-Q XT32.
Yep.
Okay.
Multi-Q. Yep.
Yeah. And then you also get things like the sub-EQ HT. So can you talk about what the sub-EQ does?
Yeah. One sub is good, two is better.
Yes.
Three is better, four is better. Mm-hmm. But what sub EQ HT does is it takes two subwoofers and makes them work together regardless mm-hmm. of where you place them. Mm-hmm. And in fact, you want to place them in sort of different locations. If you place them in very symmetric locations, they may not actually drive the room differently. Mm-hmm. So if you can place them in asymmetric locations, then let us time align them, level align them, and EQ them as one unit, mm-hmm. then you'll get probably get the best bass response mm-hmm. that way.
Yeah.
That's what HT does for you, is it measures one subwoofer, so you'll hear it in the test signal. Mm-hmm. It'll do the chirp, our log chirp.
Yeah.
Whoop. Yep. It'll do it on one, it'll do it on the other, and then it'll
sum them together.
Perform, it'll already have applied those time and level alignments. and then it will apply them. It will measure them together.
Okay. So we just went back and we talked about the fact that if you can, if the best way to fix something is to fix it acoustically by speaker placement or how the speakers interact with the room before you apply room compensation. So this is an example of the multiples of the subwoofer. So if you look here, there's the red line represents a subwoofer, and the blue line represents a subwoofer, and the green represents their response together in the room. And if you look here, right around 70 hertz, the red has a dip, but the blue one does not. So they kind of balance each other out. It doesn't remove all of that peak and dip,
right,
but it removes some of it. So if you have, so having multiple subwoofers in your room helps smooth out the response. So a lot of times if you add maybe a third, it's a good chance it may smooth it out even more. Yeah. So a lot of times we tell people, instead of buying one big 15-inch subwoofer, you'd be better off buying two 12s. The cone area is actually bigger, and you'll end up smoothing out your bass response.
So this also illustrates the headroom, the extra headroom you get from having two subwoofers.
Exactly.
They have to work less, they don't have to work as hard.
Yeah. So the multi-Q functionality allows you to best optimize. It'll optimize both sub the best way they can, and then sum them together and make sure that and optimize it again. So that is a good thing. Now there's one more thing that's in there called low frequency containment.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about what low frequency containment is?
Yeah. There are cases where you don't want to upset your neighbors, you don't want to wake up your kids. You want to dial back the bass, but you still want to have the experience as close to sort of what it would be if you had the full the full range. And so what low frequency containment does is it sort of remaps the lowest frequencies that are really easily transmitted through walls, through structures, and into higher frequencies, and allows your brain to fill in the missing part. So it gives you the experience of having the bass without the bass, everyone having the experience of the bass.
Yeah. So like we always say, some bass is better than no bass.
Yeah.
You know, of course, the best bass would be when it's disengaged. But if you just, like you said, you don't want to disturb your neighbors, this is a great solution. So there's multiple levels of Audyssey depending on the receiver that you buy. As you move up, you start getting the XT and XT32 version, which is just more what adjustment points.
More filtering power.
And then as you move even higher into the bigger, into the Platinum series, you get the ability to EQ two subs separately. Many receivers that have two sub outs, it's just the Y connection. This one means
with HT, they're separate dedicated outputs.
Yeah. Exactly. And you get the low frequency containment. So as you move up the lineup, you get a more powerful version of Audyssey. But as you move up the lineup, you also get more surround sound modes, and you also get more channels. So having this capability is a great, great thing. My favorite thing, the app. I love the app. If you go out and you buy a receiver, the receiver will basically, you plug the microphone into the receiver, will normally take the measurements, use its processing, its brain, and make the calculations to make the adjustment. If you buy the app, and the app retails for about $20, and it's available for Android and Apple devices, the way it works with that is you plug the microphone into the receiver takes the measurements, sends the information to your smartphone, your tablet, and it's the smartphone or mobile device that does the calculations, and you make all your adjustments in the phone, and then you send your final adjustments and decisions back to the receiver. Your phone is gonna have more processing power to allot to this than the receiver. I mean, if you look at most smartphones now, they have more processing power than a laptop had like 4 years ago. So you have a lot more adjustability and a lot more capabilities with the app, and I absolutely love the application. And there's lots of things you can do with it. And let's talk about some of these things. So I hear a lot, oh, I wish the Audyssey had more, you know, capabilities. I wish you could do more. I wish I can save multiple settings and see what I did and make all the adjustments. So that's where the app comes in, right? So So the first thing, you could save multiples. I've been playing with these with Jeff, because Jeff's been here, and I've learned a few things from you about this particular, about the system. And just from our conversations, I think the minor tweaks I've made over the last few days have actually made it sound better, just from just looking at what we're saying. So right now I have two or three. I can load these really quickly into the receiver. On top of this, I can have all of the receivers that are on my network I can see here. And I can go in and calibrate all of them and have all of those different curves here. So it's $20 for a license for a device. But that $20 for the license for the device is good for all of the Denon and Marantz AVRs that are in on your network. Within reason.
It's even $20 just for your account. So yeah. It's you're tied to your
Yeah, so if you have
Google
two Apple
Play Store, yeah. You can run it on all of your all of your Google devices or all of your Apple devices.
So you can have an iPad Apple, and you can have a smartphone.
And calibrate all your AVRs. And yeah, you can even, if you wanted to upgrade your AVR, you can take an old calibration or your previous calibration if nothing else has changed. And since we know we're in the same family of amplifiers and that kind of thing, you can load it into a new AVR.
And then, like I said, we're doing things like it allows you to AB. So if you have a newer Denon or Marantz AVR with dual speaker preset, I could load both of these settings. One could be maybe daytime mode, one could be nighttime mode, one could be with dynamic EQ, one could be without dynamic EQ, and I can quickly, by using the option button, AB back and forth between two of the presets. On an AV8805, it will store one, which is what we have here in an 8805. But I can quickly load one, play a track. It takes about a minute to load the other and play a track. So is it, I can't quickly AB, but if I know what I'm listening for, you know, how does the roll off affect the voice? Is it too laid back? Is it recessed? Is it at the volume? Is it less harsh with it on or with it off? You could tell that even if it takes a minute between the switch.
Yeah.
The other thing I like about it is the adjustability. If you want to maximize all of the power that is built into the Audyssey system, this is the way to go, because there's lots of settings that are available in the app that are not available in the receiver by itself. So for example, speaker detection, room, all the different room corrections, target modes, we'll talk about all of these. This goes back to what we talked about. It's going to make a decision on how big your speakers are. In this room, it said the fronts are large. They better be. You saw how big they are. The surrounds are large and the surround backs are large. Why? Because they all have 15-inch subwoofers with 1,000-watt amps. They better be large, okay? The center channel is a very large Bauer speaker, but it still needs a little bit of help at 40. 40 hertz, there's not a lot of music that plays below 40. You know, not a lot of movie content that's below 40 is low, but it's still considered small. Now, this goes back to when we did the surrounds, the top surrounds, they came up as, you know, in that, like we said, 40 or 60. And when most of the time we were playing the track, it worked perfectly fine. But then we went to like one of my favorite tracks is from Ready Player One, The First Race. And when King Kong goes by on one of the things, one of the speakers would always clip in the ceiling.
Yeah.
But just at that, at a level of like six, so if I didn't play it as loud, I didn't play that one movie, it wouldn't clip.
Yeah.
But on that one, it would. So I said, you know what? Why am I stressing my in ceilings? I'll just increase the cutoff from 60 to 80 to make it a little bit easier for them to play at higher volumes. But I could do that right here.
Subs that can handle that, no problem.
Exactly. You can do the distances. We talked about the distances. If you look at these, you may think your speakers are perfectly equally the same distance. Like if you look here, your front and so explain again why the left front and the right front look different.
They just are. There's not a lot to, the, you know, in that case, the microphone is just a half a foot closer to one than the other. And, it, you know, if you got out the measuring tape, I think it would agree with these results in this case, because there are two speakers that are fairly similar acoustically in the room, and they're powered by the same amplifier. So that's a physical distance.
Yeah. And you'll also notice that the even the levels are different between the two and the center channel. And you would think they would be the same, but because but the distance, but it the, it the microphone says that it's not.
Yeah, and that's probably acoustic differences in the room, because the in this case, you know, you could say, well, the left front is a half a foot closer, but that's probably not going to account for a dB and a half in the level.
It could just be where it's loaded. One is being reinforced by the wall, and one
slightly
is not.
More. And we do have some little bit of asymmetry in the treatments and some of the other things going on. The pillow on the couch. You never know quite what's going to adjust these or to affect these things. So
yeah, the other thing that we hear all the time:
keep the environment as close to what you're going to listen to.
The system is going to EQ each speaker. Separately. And even if you have the same speakers, we have seven of the same speakers. The center channel is the same as the left, right, center surround backs, everything. I mean all the surround speakers and the mains and the center channel are the same. But if I look at the measurements of those, they look different. So here is the front left. Now the front left has a 15 inch subwoofer. So don't look at anything below 100, because that's being held by, that's being done by a sub. But if I compare it to the center channel, even if I look below 100, 100 and above, you'll see that those speakers have a completely different response in the room. And that could be because the center channel is in the middle of the room, it's not being reinforced as much. It's now an LCR. It's mounted horizontally instead of vertically. But the how it interacts in the room at the microphone position is different.
It is.
So why does this matter? Because you don't want it to start off as a Ferrari and then change to a Dodge and then go back to a Ferrari. Or you want it to be the same car, the same airplane. If someone to walk across the room and they're talking to the person, you want that voice to be the exact same. So even though those speakers are the exact same, in order to make them sound like they're the exact same is going to require some equalization. So you may not think you need it because the speakers are great and they're the same size, but just how they interact in the room and they interact in the room differently could have an impact on your mid-range and your vocals.
And all of that said, we still allow you to turn off the EQ above whatever frequency you choose.
Exactly.
So you can, it's a feature that that some people want to hear the native response of the speaker, and it's in the app to support that demand. And you know, I think the message here is it's probably not something that is typical and that is typically needed, but it's there if you want it.
Yeah. So for example, it's called the filter range. So you can go in here, and right now we're telling Audyssey and on the filter range to go full range. But I can take this, and many times people go, I just want it to work on my bass because I'm having problems with my bass, but don't mess with my high frequency. So I can actually roll this down to 500 or 200 to have it just work on the bass if I so choose to. So you have that capability if you want to, but I just want to let you know, just on those two drawings, just because you think you may not need it,
just because they're the same speaker in the same room doesn't mean they're doing the same thing.
Exactly. I wish I had actually copied the left and the right. Their responses are different in the room. Same speaker, one for the left and one for the right, but because of the way they respond in the room, the EQ said it's slightly different. And that's just the way to go. So you may not think you need it, but there's a benefit to it. The other thing we want to talk about, and we've talked about it before, is, and we just mentioned it, it's only going to boost it so much. If there's a big dip in the room, and it looks at it and says that cannot be completely fixed or corrected, I will do as much as I can within reason. So that is a thing too. The other thing we get asked about is this thing called mid-range compensation. What is that, and why does that exist?
mid-range compensation came about as a result of tuning a lot of speakers in a lot of rooms. And mm-hmm. what we found was that on top of the basic EQ, mm-hmm. there was a need for some additional adjustment mm-hmm. that was actually remarkably consistent, mm-hmm. remarkably consistent. And so we built in mid-range compensation mm-hmm. and the general understanding behind that is that there's a difference in directivity between a tweeter mm-hmm. and a mid-range mm-hmm. and the way those directivities change through the crossover region mm-hmm. causes a difference in the perception mm-hmm. of the power of the sound. Mm-hmm. And so what you, not only was this something that we've just found was necessary in a lot of speakers, it turns out it's built into a lot of speakers from the designers. And mm-hmm. and they're, you know, they know that their speakers anechoically aren't a flat, mm-hmm. ruler flat response mm-hmm. and that they don't need to be and mm-hmm. that they shouldn't be.
Yeah, it's about how it sounds. Mm-hmm. Now, the interesting thing about this was when before you came, I had this turned off. Mm-hmm. I had it turned on for the top front, the top front, the top rear, and the top middle, the six speakers in the ceiling. But I had it switched off on the larger Bowers that's all the way around the room. Mm-hmm. Then we started, you pointed out something to me in the drawing, and you were saying, if you look at the speaker, you'll see that right around the 2000 range on these are custom cinema, they're designed for cinema applications, mm-hmm. every single one of them had a dip right around 2K. Mm-hmm. The top surrounds, the rear surrounds, the center channel, the fronts, they all had that little bit of a dip.
Yeah.
So it was actually built into the speaker. And what I was doing when I was running it flat, I was actually taking out yeah. something that the guy, the designer who made the speaker actually put in. So if you look at this, you can see that there is a dip that is actually built in, as you can see in these particular drawings. As I go through and I look at the surround back, same speaker, CT mm-hmm. CT 0.8, they had a little mid-range compensation built in. Yeah. So me running it ruler flat was taking out some of the character they put into it based on what they believe it would sound best in a movie application. So I turned it back on mm-hmm. and guess what? I like it that way.
Yeah.
You know, I think it actually sounds better. And it's hard to tell somebody that you want to put a dip in. They go, no, it's got to be really flat. And then you see, then they see the response, the native response of the speaker, and they see the native response for the speaker has a dip in it.
Yeah.
You know, so it was kind of an enlightening thing. So these graphs.
I'll even go as a starting point when I see a really consistent, these aren't quite as consistent as I've seen, mm-hmm. but if you, especially across the front three though, mm-hmm. if you see a really consistent, uniform little dip in the mid-range mm-hmm. It's probably there for the by design mm-hmm. and I like to copy it so mm-hmm. I like to go into the target curve editor and mm-hmm. it's sometimes so ours is right around 2K mm-hmm. sometimes it makes sense to shift it just a little down mm-hmm. or just a little up mm-hmm. depending on the crossover design of the speaker yeah. mm-hmm. and so I'll as a starting point I'll match what the speaker mm-hmm. designers
yeah so you can kind of see where they kind of put that in and yeah. kind of put it in there. And that leads us to the other thing that I like talking about is the ability to make custom curves. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't normally, we say that boosting is not always, you don't really want to boost something. If you can attenuate it, it's better. Mm-hmm. But because if you, as you boost 3 dB, yeah, you're doubling the power that is required. So 3 dB, you're doubling the power that's required. So a lot of times, you know, it's better just to use it to boost at a minimum. But then I was looking at this and I was like, oh, it sounds good. But Brendan, who's our head of engineering, says this should play lower and more, it should have more authority at really, really low volumes. And it was measured flat. But then we looked at the measurements and I said, wow, there is a tremendous amount of bass down in these in these lower ranges. If you look here at the 20 hertz thing, at 20 hertz, it's up 10 dB. Okay, so I said, wow, no one's gonna look at 20 hertz, King Kong running through the room and say, don't put that back.
Yeah.
So all I did, if you look at the drawing, was I came up with a curve that kind of did the same thing. I'm not boosting any of that. And then if you look as it comes down, I'm trying to put the minimum amount of boost by maintaining the deeper bass. I didn't want to boost like the 80 hertz and the 100 hertz and the 50, 60, because it gets a little boomy. Mm-hmm. It gets a little soft. But I wanted that just guttural deepness. And it was already there.
And you can feel it.
And you could feel it in this room. Yeah. So I kind of followed this curve. So it looks crazy.
Yeah.
The first time I did it. But it sounds really good. No one's going to look at that and say, I don't want a 10 dB boost at 20 hertz. No one is going to look at that and not want that. So I kind of came with these curves. I looked at it and said, where can I boost it? Where can I not? Where should I not boost it? How can I just use what's already there, but just smooth it out and utilize that extra bass response that was in the speaker?
So and this is a tough one, because I do promise you that if you were to have that flat and turn dynamic EQ on so that when you turn the volume down, mm-hmm. it keeps up some of the punch, mm-hmm. that would be as close as we can get you to a reference experience. Mm-hmm. But most people do like a little more, especially in the home. It seems to work well. And back to the question about the demo, mm-hmm. it would demo kind of poorly if the EQ on took away some of the bass.
Exactly.
So that's definitely like a case by case call of how you want to treat
that. Yeah, because people think they want flat response. Most people want smooth response with a little bit of fatter bottom end. Yeah. So I went in and I just put in 3 points, and you just basically touch the screen and you can put where you want to point and you can put turn where you want to do that. The little dip was because I have the the compensation on, the mid-range compensation mm-hmm. on. And like I said, if you look at the original chart, there was that kind of a dip naturally in the speaker. I just put it back and made sure that the sound is smoother. Then you have this little roll off. What's going on here? Mm-hmm.
That is our reference curve. So that is the reference high frequency roll off. Mm-hmm. And it helps with the translation from theater to home mm-hmm. in most cases, mm-hmm. depending on the content. So we talked a bit about it before, mm-hmm. And you've got also the high frequency roll off too, mm-hmm. which might be applicable in a more reverberant or larger room, mm-hmm. Or it might not.
You just so basically try it.
Right? I at this point, I really recommend trying it and choosing what you like. And mm-hmm. these can also just be starting points. So if you play with high frequency roll off one mm-hmm. and try high frequency roll off two, and you like one of them more than the other, then you can kind of keep making incremental adjustments in mm-hmm. in the direction that you like.
Yeah, and exactly. And that's what we did here, was I played with it. We said we need to have more bass. I played with it. I put too much in that 60 hertz. So if I was building a car to play hip hop, or if this was all about the hip hop, that Home Theater 2 was awesome for Beastie Boys and like if you just want the boom of a car stereo system. But I was like, no, that's not what I'm looking for. I want clean, tight kick drum. But then if there is a spaceship that passed over, I wanted that. So and then we started playing with the roll-offs and the curves and whether or not we had mid-range compensation.
The high frequency roll-off one works really well.
Exactly. Here. And I guarantee you, as we go along, I'll probably have another one. I'll probably have another one that says Home Theater once we get the final without treatments, and I'll do final with treatments. Mm-hmm. And I bet you those curves are going to be
a little different. Yeah,
exactly. So I think, like I said, the tool, this app is just an incredible tool. So you have all the stuff we talked about, including, like I said, that curve editor where you can build your own curves. Now you if I take this and say it didn't have this 20 hertz, just because I go plus 15 does not mean it's going
to
do it, right?
Doesn't mean you're going to get it, right? Uh-huh. If it was already boosting a few dB to get to zero, uh-huh. then asking it to go 10 dB above zero isn't going to go. Okay. And you'll see that same sort of like it doesn't match what you asked mm-hmm. for. So
exactly.
This is the target
we're
trying to achieve.
Yeah, so if you look at these top fronts, they can't go that deep.
Yeah.
So I can go in and say all I want that I want that same curve that I'm having, that I'm using for my main speakers mm-hmm. that have 15 and subs, but you can ask all you want.
Yeah.
You know, I can only do so much when it comes to how I utilize the signal.
On the flip side, we get this question a lot, what you see is what you get. Mm-hmm. So the after, it may be a digital simulation, mm-hmm. but it's a digital simulation that we know works, mm-hmm. and it always works in every room, mm-hmm. in every situation. When we the room is, in the engineering sense, mm-hmm. it's a linear system. It mm-hmm. works very, very linearly. Mm-hmm. So if we say we're going to put in 10 dB, mm-hmm. we get 10 dB. Mm-hmm. So this is the representation of what you would get across all positions. Mm-hmm. So if you want to verify it, it's kind of a tricky thing, mm-hmm. because you would need to use a similar weighting average system, mm-hmm. that we use. There's some,
so trying to apply the equalization involved, and the measurement simultaneously too,
yeah,
would be a huge amount of processing.
Huge amount of processing power. So one of the reasons we don't is the complexity of trying to both measure and run the EQ simultaneously, mm-hmm. which is taxing on the DSP. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we know it works. So
yeah, but
we've run this experiment thousands of times in thousands of rooms and thousands, mm-hmm. of speakers.
Yeah, and like I said, there's a little bit of smoothing applied.
There's some smoothing, yeah.
Yeah,
but and it's the same smoothing before as it is after, so it's not a. There's
also,
a
they're both smooth. The green one and the other one are
they're
smooth
both
about
smooth
the
same amount.
So when it says it's pretty ruler flat, it's pretty ruler.
It's really pretty ruler flat in yeah. a smooth in the same amount of smoothing. So mm-hmm. if it looks rough before and it gets smooth after, it is making that much difference. It
wow,
absolutely is.
So that's a really cool thing.
Yeah.
So and like I said, we talked about the other things that are on here, which, for example, we talked about the fact that I can go into the receiver and I can turn on dynamic volume or dynamic EQ, mm-hmm. or low frequency containment, or I could turn it on here. So you can
right.
use, so some of the capabilities and settings are available in the AVR's menu, and they're available in the app. And some things,
and we've heard the request that we want to see them all in the app. So that is definitely, mm-hmm. we've definitely heard it. Mm-hmm. And we'll see what we can do.
Yeah. The other thing too is here's the now this is a subwoofer. Is this the summed of the subwoofers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now one thing that I thought was really cool was we did a webinar a few months ago about
this was cool. I encourage people to do this for themselves because mm-hmm. it's one of those seeing is believing sort of things. I'd mm-hmm. seen this experiment done by other people before, but mm-hmm. Doing it in my house, in my own space, was really was really proof. Mm-hmm. So I placed the subwoofer literally in the middle of my couch. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to do that, be careful.
Yeah.
Don't poke holes in your upholstery.
Mm-hmm.
And I placed the microphone in kind of in the corner, mm-hmm. just a random sort of like what happens here, mm-hmm. under the coat rack. And I measured the response. And you can see that in the first graph, in the top graph.
Mm-hmm.
And it shows the before and after. We can kind of ignore the after for now, mm-hmm. but look at the before response. And then look what happens when I switch the microphone back into the listening position and move the subwoofer under the coat rack, mm-hmm. under the coats, mm-hmm. in the corner. And they're astonishingly similar. Mm-hmm. They're not, you can see they're different. Mm-hmm. There are some differences, especially in the higher frequencies, mm-hmm. but for the most part, they're exactly what you want to know, which is if you do this, if you take the app and you put the subwoofer in your listening position and then you move the microphone around the room, mm-hmm. and it's a little bit of a slow process.
But
so
you can really find the best spot to put the subwoofer.
You can find really you can find a very correctable spot. And so mm-hmm. We might see in another slide here what happens if you don't put the subwoofers where they belong, but also the benefit of having two subwoofers.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So actually, before we can go into that, so mm-hmm. that's a good point. Like you can use this, so say you have one or maybe two subwoofers and you're willing to take the time,
yeah.
And you're really like you guys out there that are maniacs, you could literally use that microphone on a Saturday to find the optimum spot.
Yeah, now, set it to 2.1,
uh-huh.
it goes a lot faster,
mm-hmm.
and you can just leave it in one position for one place, and because you have to do a minimum of
yeah.
three positions uh-huh. before you get to look at it and uh-huh. stuff like that.
Now you know, darn it, that
don't
I'm gonna be here. I'm gonna do that with these two subwoofers because why not?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I'm gonna actually do it for these two subwoofers to find the optimum space for the subwoofers in this room. And I think I'm gonna go back and do it in my house. But
oh, yeah.
then, like I said, in this space, I could put the subwoofers wherever I want.
Mm-hmm.
But most of you have a design committee that will not allow you to put everything wherever you want. So sometimes, whether it's the it's a second person or your own personal preference, that you just don't want the sub in that spot.
Physical constraints of the space.
Physical constraints of the space that it cannot happen. And that's where the multiple subs come in. So tell me what. So explain what you did here.
Sure. I mean, this is the two subwoofers in the picture and my cat. But let's focus on the subwoofers. There's a it actually looks like a mission style end table, but it's a subwoofer. Right there, on the right side as we look at the picture. And then on the left side in the black hole in the corner is a subwoofer as well. So we can see that the left one has a terrible response and the after correction is terrible. It just can't correct that. We've got the right subwoofer has a terrible response and the after correction it is terrible as well. It can't correct that. And we look at both together and it is a still a pretty terrible before response, but it's pretty correctable. It gets real close. So, I mean, this just illustrates where you can take two subwoofers and go from horrible and horrible to really pretty okay.
Exactly.
And so, especially with the EQ on top.
Yeah. So if we keep it really simple, multiple subwoofers give you more place and flexibility.
Lots of options. Yeah.
Okay. So I thought this was really cool.
And now
this
if is I listen to my experiment and I put the subwoofers in the best positions, we'd start out with better responses. The EQ would have to do less work. Everything would be, it would sound better, I think.
Yeah. And that goes back to what we said before. Proper placement. room treatments, electronic compensation. If you follow that, you will optimize the performance of what you have. And a lot of times your system will sound better than someone who spent a lot more money by taking a little bit of time. And this is an example of how this app, the cool things you can do with $20 for an app.
You get creative with the tools and you can find some interesting solutions. Yeah.
So Frederick, do we have any questions?
Okay, so after running Audyssey, can we change the subwoofer gain on the back of the subwoofer and leave the subwoofer level at 0 dB? Or should I be rerunning every time I change the gain on the back of the subwoofer? That's an obvious one.
With a single subwoofer, it's your preference. I will say it's your preference. If you the EQ shouldn't change, assuming your subwoofer is linear in its gain function. So the EQ should be okay with a single subwoofer. With multiple subwoofers, I highly advise against touching the back of the subwoofer after calibration. Just don't touch anything. Use the AVR trims if you want a little more sub. That's what those are for. And if you so when you have two subwoofers and you're using sub EQHT, move them both together. So if you decide you want a couple dB more bass. Move both of them two dB.
Exactly. Yep. And that goes back to me being a lazy man. And so why would you go back and turn the knob when I can just go like this, go here, and now I have both my subwoofers right there.
Yeah.
If I want 3 dB, I can do it right here.
You've done them both
exactly without turning my knob, without having to get off of my couch.
Right.
You know, so to me, this ensures that you're not messing with any of the Audyssey parameters. You can make this boost because you're now rocking a rock and roll thing and you want that fat bass or whatever. You can make that adjustment and it's not overly affecting the it's not impacting the reference Audyssey mix that is already there.
Right.
So to me, I think that's the best way to do it.
Now, talking about sub-EQHT, does on an individual subwoofer-based EQ devices like the Marantz 8805 apply EQ to an individual sub or to both subs combined? And following on, if combined, how does it EQ for a diagonally, non-symmetrically placed subwoofer in a rectangular room?
Many questions in one.
Okay. Stump the Jeff there. They are throwing bombs at
it's
you.
Good. Yeah, this is actually, I like this question. So the content sent to the subwoofer output is mono. So it's definitely mono from the LFE, and it's treated as mono when you've downmixed the bass from any channel. So in this case, we've downmixed the center channel bass and the ceiling bass into a single content channel. And so there's really just no value in EQing the subwoofers separately. There's no need to. Mm-hmm. They perform as a unit, and so we EQ them as a unit.
Yeah, because it's about the bass in the listening position where the microphone is.
Yeah, and you know, it's even counterproductive mm-hmm. to EQ them beforehand, because when you combine them in the room, so you could measure one subwoofer and you can measure the other subwoofer, and we actually can predict how they're going to combine, mm-hmm. and they do combine the way we would predict. But if you were to EQ them separately, you'd end up undoing mm-hmm. some of that EQ mm-hmm. when you EQ'd them together. Mm-hmm. So there's actually just no need to do it.
Yeah.
So it's very efficient to processing wise. We can just treat it as yeah. one output yeah. On the EQ filter side, mm-hmm. but we do treat them separately on the time and level side. Mm-hmm. And so those are the things we don't want to upset after we've chosen an EQ curve for them.
Yeah. Yeah. Carson's got jokes today. He was talking about, I wonder how a moving cat influences the acoustics of a room. Does your cat dampen your bass? You know,
if it's close to the microphone, that's not good. It's not good.
Or they're smacking the microphone while you're actually watching it.
Or biting the cable. Yep. I don't know how many microphones. My cat likes to eat the microphone cables.
The other thing too was my whole thing about Carson was like, high tech makes you lazy. So instead of getting off the couch to turn the knob, I'm just going to bring up the channel level and make the adjustment.
So regarding the diagonal asymmetric subwoofers, I love diagonal asymmetric subwoofers. I do not care for symmetric subwoofers.
Ah, we talked about this.
Yeah.
Why don't you care for symmetric
subwoofers? So if I have a perfectly rectangular room and I put a subwoofer in the front left corner and I put a subwoofer in the front right corner, those subwoofers are performing in acoustically the same location.
So every peak and null is going to be the same.
They're going to be the same. They're mm-hmm. going to perform at least up the middle of the room, at least in symmetric points of the room, mm-hmm. you're going to see the same response in both points. So it's much better to drive the room from two different points. Mm-hmm.
So basically, like we talked about in this drawing right here, if these two subs were symmetrically paced in a rectangular room, the blue and red would almost track the same. So they're not going to help each other.
Right.
Because this room, we're using two subs, and either because even if they were placed so they look symmetrical, because the room may not be symmetrical, their peaks and dips are different.
Right.
And then you end up with, you end up flattening it.
I think we're in a symmetrical room, right?
It's like, well, this room is a little longer than it is.
Right.
We built this room.
Not square, but at least side to side,
exactly.
it's a perfect mirror. So
yeah.
In homes, that's a little less common. Mm-hmm. There's usually some like an opening on one side, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. it still happens. So diagonally, it will time align the subwoofers, so mm-hmm. it will find the two distances mm-hmm. and it will delay the closer subwoofer so that it appears as far as mm-hmm. the farther subwoofer. So now they're playing at the same time. Mm-hmm. The sound from each of them is arriving mm-hmm. to the listener at the same time. If one of them's further or it's a different kind of subwoofer and mm-hmm. it's less sensitive, mm-hmm. it'll bring that level up mm-hmm. or it will lower the level of the louder one depending on what's necessary. Mm-hmm. So they'll both be playing at the same level. So they'll be contributing the same acoustic power mm-hmm. in the listening position. Mm-hmm. The subwoofers themselves may not be putting out the same amount of power mm-hmm. because they're driving the room from different positions. Mm-hmm. But in the listening position, the received power is the same.
One thing I do that, I've noticed that. So I have two Super Cube 8000s in my room. Mm-hmm. I have one in the front next to my mains. Mm-hmm. I have one in the back behind my couch mm-hmm. and the system EQs them. And like I said, when I'm playing, you can't localize where the one's coming from.
Right.
And the bass is on this big, huge couch is buttery smooth. Any place in the room, the bass is good. So summing them, I mean, EQing them and then summing them together, all you're caring about is what it sounds like at your seat.
Right.
And the microphone is trying to take those two subs, combine them in the best way possible to give you the best smooth, flat bass response at where that microphone, those microphones were placed. Now, that's another reason why you want to do multiple positions, mm-hmm. because that gives you it gives the system a better understanding of the space, right?
You have two ears, you sit in different positions, you lean forward when you're listening really critically, mm-hmm. you relax when you're just listening more casually, mm-hmm. but you still want great sound either way. Mm-hmm. So put the microphone in all different positions. Mm-hmm. There's some guidance about 18 inches. You can use that. You can, but whatever you do, measure where there are ears.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, at ear level and
ear level multiple. and in places not over here near the wall, but in the unless somebody sits there, somebody has to stand against the wall and listen, then maybe you EQ it. But
okay.
Yeah. Okay. And then we might as well talk about Y chords as well. Mm-hmm. So if you have more than two subwoofers, then it is a good idea to put subwoofers that are the same distance on a Y chord. Mm-hmm. So if you have to Y chord, put them make sure those subwoofers are at the same distance, preferably of the same type. So you know that there's none of that electronic delay or that the electronic delay is the same for both of them. Mm-hmm. And then either with the app, or with an SPL meter, make sure that the level of the two subwoofers that are on the Y chord
are
very close. And you can do that by testing one and then the other with the app or with an SPL meter.
Yeah, so when we do demos, we always try to take four. I have two in this room because we're cyanided. I get the stuff for free. Yeah. I'm going to put two more in here.
Yeah.
Not because I need more bass, but because I want it to be smoother. I want to smooth the bass out even further. Mm-hmm. And nice thing about being a speaker company, I get speakers for free.
Yeah.
And especially for our demo room. So why not use everything I possibly can to maximize the sound?
So yeah, a question for you, Phil. You've made six speakers in your setup large by using separate subwoofers, but why not on the center channel?
Ah, that is a very good question. The reason why we couldn't put it on the center channel was because of these. I actually had one on the center channel. By the way, there was the reason why it's sitting on that stand is because I temporarily have it sitting on that stand. The problem was when I put the center on the 15, it blocked for the TV because I didn't have enough room for that.
That's a solvable problem.
So what I was thinking about doing is they make what's called a CTSW12. And I was thinking about putting two under the center channel. And that would mean that it would be low enough to clear
But you want to raise it anyway, right?
Yeah, I'm probably going to raise the TV, so I may go back to a 15.
Yeah, so
look at these guys. They're trying to spend my money, actually my boss's money, on even more subwoofers, as if 7 6/15s and two DB1Ds is not enough bass in this room. Do I think I need it? Why not?
Nice to have, but yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
You don't need it, but it'd be fun.
It'll be fun. Yeah.
So Manoj has a good question. Going back to dynamic EQ. So if we filter the speaker frequency range that Audyssey works, let's say 300 hertz and below only, and turn on dynamic EQ, does it still boost some of the highs? Yeah. Or is dynamic EQ independent from the filter?
Dynamic EQ is independent from the filter. So it does its own thing in its own module, and it will boost regardless. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so you can have both of them. So you can have them both on. You can have this set for your reference level volume, and then you can have dynamic EQ and make some things for
right. So if you drag this curtain down and lower the frequency range, it will still dynamic EQ will still affect the high
full range. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The EQ won't.
Good question. That is a great question.
Yeah.
I've never heard that one, and that is an excellent question.
Okay, regarding microphone placement, and there seems to be a bit of misunderstanding on the positions and or the number of positions. So I understand he says that we need to measure the positions to get the room information within 2 feet as a radius from the main listening point. So should I be testing in such a way that when a microphone is placed 6 inches or 1 foot or 1.5 or maybe 2 feet gap radius, for all 8 positions and decide which one sounds better? What's the general recommendation here?
The recommendation depends on your goal. In the case that you only care about you, you're super selfish and you want my seat to be good and I don't care about anything else. then you can measure in sort of
a
very small window that is your head size and where your head might mm-hmm. be. So if you're going to lean forward sometimes and lean back sometimes, then you might have a very narrow range of, mm-hmm. of microphone mm-hmm. positions. Even so, sometimes I find that spreading the positions out helps that main position. Mm-hmm. It's really it's unfortunate that there's a little art to it.
Exactly.
And so, I mean, if you're seeing the exact same response in a lot of positions, if they're really not varying much, mm-hmm. then varying the microphone a mm-hmm. little bit mm-hmm. can help. If you want everybody on the couch to have a really good experience, mm-hmm. then you definitely don't worry about this the 6-inch, 18-inch rule, 24-inch rule. Mm-hmm. Put the microphone. I always start with, and I vary the height a little bit because mm-hmm. you know I'm a different height from my kids, mm-hmm. So their ears are lower mm-hmm. And mine are higher, and so I'll vary the microphone kind of randomly mm-hmm. on the different positions because we may all sit different places. Mm-hmm. And we'll take all 8 positions that mm-hmm. were allowed. Mm-hmm. And some of them will be kind of leaning kind of towards the back of the couch mm-hmm. because we lean back, and some of them, a couple of them. Mm-hmm. I do once in a while want to just get in there and mm-hmm. listen. Mm-hmm. Most of the time I'm pretty relaxed. Mm-hmm. And so I don't want to take lots of positions mm-hmm. When I'm not going to be spending much time mm-hmm. leaning forward. So I focus on where my ears are.
Mm-hmm. And like I said, one of the things that we talked about before goes back to the newer receivers mm-hmm. is the newer Denon and Marantz receivers have dual speaker presets.
Super cool.
So you can do the tight positioning for the one person who probably wrote the check for everything, which is you guys out there probably. And then you can do the family. So you can have a family one or a wider one for when you entertain.
That's a great use. For when you entertain, you might actually measure by the wall and you might measure all around the room. Mm-hmm. So if you, and that's a great use of that feature, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think
speaking of that, Phil.
Say again?
Speaking of that, is there a way you can demonstrate it? Because somebody was asking, how do you switch from one speaker setup to the other on the AV8805? That's what you're having there.
On the AV8805, let me, it's going to be, it's a little bit more work on one of the Denon, on one of the newer receivers, an 8015 or a 6700 Denon, the unit has 2 presets. And I do an Audyssey calibration, I save it to preset 1. And I do an Audyssey calibration, I save it to preset 2. And then when I hit the option button on the remote control, along with, I got to come out of here. When I hit the option button on a new remote control, along with these options that you see here, you'll see one called speaker preset, and you can quickly switch from here. The AV8805 does not have this. So what I do is we get a lot of people who come in to do demos here, and sometimes it's a group. And I know, okay, hey, we're bringing in a group of analysts, and they want to hear all of the stuff, right? So what I do is, remember we said that the receiver it takes about a minute to load something. So if I'm gonna do something, I can actually go in here and I can measure, I have 2 couches, 2 what, 5-foot, 6-foot long couches. I can do a really wide one because I know I'm gonna have 6 or 8 people in here because I'm doing a demo for a retailer, a bunch of sales guys, you know, a bunch of our internal employees. And I can make one called theater, you know, big group, right? Then I can put one called the boss, mm-hmm. right? And I can take one position on that couch and I can just make, and then I can move that mic around yeah. and they could say, hey, Phil, the boss is coming. He wants to hear it. And I go into boss mode, you know, right. and I say, hey, boss, hey, Kevin. Sit right here. And then he gets the optimum experience. And they say, hey, Phil, we have about 6 people coming or 8 people coming. Can you do a demo? I can switch it to group mode.
Right.
And then I just load that in. That's one of the benefits of having the app. Is it instantaneous, like on dual speaker preset where it's a press of a button and you can do it in a second? No, but being able to switch between these presets in a minute, to me alone, makes that app worth $20.
Mm-hmm. And the way you would do that is you would tap on one of these,
You would pick
Theater or Theater 2. You would pick one of those,
and then you would hit this button hit this little arrow. And you say, I want to upload, and it says, what receiver do you want to upload this to? Mm-hmm. The AV8805, and it just uploads it.
Yep.
So then that's why they're labeled theater, because I have one that's going to be, there's going to be a classroom one, and it's going to be all the different receivers. So I know that I can have all of my, on my phone, I can have all of the EQs for the showrooms and the classrooms on my phone, and I can quickly make adjustments.
Yeah.
For,
or
you know,
fix them.
Or fix them.
After someone messes with it.
You know, so.
So how many presets can you store? How many presets can you store in the app then? Is there a limitation or?
Not that I know.
Technically, you could have one for the boss. You could have like an individual library of different, which brings us to the next question anyway. But So first of all, a question from Anosh again. So with newer and better speakers resolving the issues of that mid-range compensation, which they are supposed to resolve, can mid-range compensation be set to default off instead of default on? So I think right now default is on.
So let's talk about it.
That's an interesting question.
But hold on. The speakers that are in this room are $7,000 Bowers CT theaters. Okay. That is one of the, they did that on purpose.
Yeah.
Okay. For this application. If they wanted that to be flat, they could have made that flat. Okay. I mean, even I'm sure,
we're gonna have to talk to them.
Yeah, I know. So while we're talking about this compensation, they put that in there. That was their decision. Not because if you look at that speaker at $7,000 or $8,000 a piece, $16,000 for two of these. If they wanted that to go away,
it's gone.
Bowers would have took it out. But they believe that in a theater environment, it sounds better.
So I think they're referring to, I mean, there are some interesting designs. You have coaxial drivers.
Yeah.
You do. There are some other interesting designs out there that I definitely agree this wouldn't be applicable.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Like, but you'll see it if you measure it.
You won't necessarily have that. You'll still have the change in directivity, though, even with a coaxial driver. So I'm not really sure
So the best way to say it would be, the nice thing about being able to see both, the before and the after, if you look at the before and there isn't a dip, just turn it off in here.
Yeah.
If you look at the
response.
That doesn't
mean it's not applicable. I mean, there are some speaker designers who philosophically and because of maybe marketing reasons are going to flatten the speaker, maybe unnecessarily. So you never know.
Exactly.
I always say try it.
Yeah.
Your ears will tell you.
Yeah. So if you look at the speaker, and you're looking at the surround, or you're looking at one of the speakers, and you go, wow, when I'm looking at the surround or the speaker I'm using for surround, I don't see a dip.
Mm-hmm.
You may opt not to put the dip in.
Yeah.
But
it might be that it just has coincided with some room effect.
Exactly.
Experimentation. I start with it and almost every time that I take it out, I wish that I hadn't. So
and that's a big point, is a lot of this still comes down to experimentation, because I always say there's perfection and there's preference. If flat should be perfection, but many companies have tried to make a perfectly flat speaker, and everybody hates the way they sound. There's always either a little bit of a tilt.
Mm-hmm.
People want smooth, not flat.
Yeah.
So a lot of times perfection doesn't apply to the preference of a human. So that's one of the benefits of having this app, is you can go in and you can play with a different target curve. You may say, well, I like brand X's freaking slope. Well, guess what? You can go in there and you can make, by using the curve editor, a slope that matches the guy that you think sounds better.
Yeah.
And then you could, or the slope that you think you like that position.
There are a lot of theories, and some of the things are science-based. So, I mean, like, for instance, mid-range compensation.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a tweeter and you have a mid-range, the directivity has shifted, and it's very hard to design a crossover that doesn't mm-hmm. sort of mm-hmm. exhibit that effect.
Yeah.
So the easy way is to EQ it out a little bit.
Exactly. So, but you have the ability to go in and try out everybody else's curve. So if you saw another curve that you like, or you heard that this curve is better, or you should boost this, or you should flatten that. Mm-hmm. The nice thing about the app is you have way more flexibility in the app than you will have in the receiver to take these things out, to add stuff, to make your own adjustments, to make your own mid-range. I've heard it should not be mid-range at 2K. It should be mid-range at 3K. Flatten, turn this one off, and put a dip in it using the curve editor.
Been there, done that.
Yeah. So you can make all of that. I love being able to experiment. If you get the app, if you don't have it, you could spend a lot of time experimenting with it. And now it's with great power comes great responsibility. So you can go in and make all the tweaks and say, oh, this sounds horrible, because you went in there and turned everything off and bent this and straightened that and flattened that and boosted this. And you basically, because you have the capability, doesn't mean that you should always use it. Yeah. So I always say, every chase, you should always save the original. I didn't do it, but you should always save the original, right?
It's easy to get back.
Yeah. Cause all I gotta do is just turn. All I gotta do is hit delete those points.
Yep.
And you should have an original and then a couple of experiments and then play some stuff until you find the one that you like best. Mm-hmm. And then that becomes your settings.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, no matter what, if we had all of the science to say that this is perfect EQ, it's not ever going to be perfect for everyone. Mm-hmm. Everyone is going to see it and hear it a little differently. Mm-hmm. And so there's a place for preference on top of, mm-hmm. on top of what we're doing, which is as close scientifically to reference as we can get. Mm-hmm.
So I think we have to let you guys go. As always, the questions are outstanding. Mm-hmm. I know that Frederick and Jen are going to download the questions, and everything that we did not get to, we are going to also answer them and get back to you, because Jen and Frederick have your emails. So we're going to give them to Jeff, and then he's going to help us answer them and get you back your answers. We're going to make two videos. One is about how the Audyssey works and how to operate. And then there's been so many good questions on the Q&A. I'm going to make a second video. So there were questions in the first session that were outstanding. So at this session, you still want to watch the Q&A, because you're going to see all of these questions plus all of those great questions from the first session. So as always, Jeff, thank you for being a great sport.
Thank you for having me.
Every year on June 30th,
we're
going to have to do this, because now we have a tradition of 2 years in a row.
I think we'll see you before then.
Exactly. Hopefully. I think you will.
Yeah.
And of course, we always want to thank Frederick with his beautiful background, mm-hmm. Which almost looks like a store, but that's actually his living room. And Jen, who is hiding in the shadows. I haven't even heard her voice the entire time.
I am here. I've been listening the whole time, and I'm here.
Yeah.
Truly made this happen. So
exactly. By the way, we have these sessions. We have four booked right now. We have other people coming as well. We're talking about, of course, we have the acoustic treatment one and the one with AudioQuest. We have one with the people that did all of our video distribution. We're gonna do one with Luxel for all of the switching and the networking capabilities. We have a lot of other companies that are gonna come through who have partnered with us to help the space, and the space will continue to evolve. So every time you see it, next time we're in the theater, it may have all its acoustic treatments in it. It all depends on if John gets them done in time. So please make sure that you continue to check, what is it, www.signad.com/webinars, right?
Forward slash webinars.
Yes, so Jen will kill me. And also make sure that you are subscribed to the YouTube channel, which I know you guys are. So thank you for coming. I got to send Jeff off to bed. And I know Jen's ready to go to bed. She's probably in her pajamas right now. And Frederick, it's early morning. He's probably going to go out and have
lunch. It's a day off. Yeah, it's a day off for us.
Okay. Oh, so you're really a spirit, really a good sport. All right. So take care, everybody. Thank you for coming. And we will talk to you soon.